morning, and thank you very much for joining us. I am Yori Folarin. Let's stay in the polity, but perhaps in particular, no, it's not really the polity, because there shouldn't be politics when we want to talk about the judiciary, right? So we're trying to talk about the judiciary. The judiciary would appear, I don't know, depends on how you look at it, would appear to be in the eye of the storm right now. Now, following the raids by the DSS over the weekend, almost as equally widely condemned as hailed, depending on what side you're on, we thought we'd just continue and bring an eminent senior citizen who has seen through the publics, seen through the decades, and get his perspective on where we are now in relation to, I don't know if it is exactly right to call it an upheaval, but certainly there's a lot of activity in the judiciary, morally speaking. As you recall, the Attorney General sent a further 6 names of judges to be probed, in addition to those that were concerned in the weekend sting. And this has not gone down well with some, in particular the law community. Just about half of them, as far as I can tell, say that, look, there is due process. We're not quarreling with what was done, but there is a way to go about it. And of course, there are other lawyers who, you know, say, whereas they don't have anything against due process, let's get pragmatic here. Let's get realistic here. But Mr. Ayo Opadokun is a legal practitioner as well. He is, among other things, you know, convener of a Coalition of Democrats for Electoral Reform. I don't know that that's the particular area of emphasis today, no. But thank you very, very much for coming on, Mr. Opadokun.
It's a pleasure.
You are a lawyer yourself.
Yes.
So you have a stake in this, in how the law is seen.
Very, very much so. I dare say, without blowing any trumpet, that in 1988, by the grace of God, I was the editor of the only authoritative journal of the Nigerian Bar Association, Law and Practice Journal, under the golden presidency of Alaa Akabashon. So you can understand where we're coming from. But today, I'm the convener of the Movement for Value Restoration.
Okay.
I'm coming under that auspices because the entire geographical edifice called Nigeria is under siege as a result of the crisis in the Nigerian judiciary. So, viewers, we're here.
Okay. Now, first of all, everybody will agree that, well, before I go to what everybody will agree with, my personal thoughts, you know, would be that we have to have a judiciary that every country needs a judiciary that the country can depend on. But in the light of allegations from the Attorney General of the Federation against the NJC in particular, where he says it's unconscionable that names that have been forwarded to the Judicial Council for investigation have been wantonly disregarded, and apparently that is why they had sent them over to the DSS. Give me your impressions on that particular technical matter, because there are those who are saying that it should be the work of the NJC, not the DSS, to investigate errant lawyers.
Thank you, Yori. I dare say that a significant majority of the critics of the sting operation of the DSS are engaging in misplaced and transferred aggression against an otherwise productive government agency that has been set up by the Constitution for the protection of all of us. There are a few preliminary statements or matters that we must settle forthwith. One, it is a fact that no one can dispute that judges don't have constitutional immunity, that they are like you and I. When they are within the court premises, as first of all, they are lawyers. And lawyers, either on the bench or at the bar, are supposed to be ministers in the temple of justice. They are supposed to perform their acts in accordance with the dictates of the law. So when such elements, people who are being so honored, go outside the language of law upon which they were admitted into the law school, being fit and proper, they've opened their flank. They must be ready to answer their questions, bordering on their conduct and their behavior. So, therefore, I am one of those who believe that the Nigerian judiciary, as represented by the NJC, and the senior lawyers are engaged in transferred, misplaced aggression and hypocrisy. When it is not because, it's because most of these matters have been known to the NJC and these senior lawyers. Some of them, between 6 months and 1 year ago.
Falana put out a statement, I think, or an article, where, summarizing it into a one-liner, he had said that, don't blame DSS, blame yourselves, NBA, NJC.
That's what I mean. It is self-inflicted. The NJC had really misperformed, underperformed, and have been a source of worry and concern to many of us. There are quite a number of matters that have been placed within the purview and responsibility of the NJC, for which they have deterred, vacillated, and they have acted below expectation. And come to think of this, let me give you one or two instances. The allegations against the judge who has 2 billion naira in his account, and he says, from the farm.
Okay, that lady judge.
That, what has the Nigerian judiciary, the NJC, done? Should that woman remain in office, for God's sake? What has happened to that? The allegation against Ricky Taffer and the judge, into whose account he was alleged to have fixed money. What has the NJC done against that? Look, the NJC, and of in this circumstance, there is a Justice Pendiga, who the DSS, with tape recorded confessional statement of this Justice Pendiga, had nearly confessed to having a deal of 500 million naira with the sitting Chief Justice of Nigeria. And then our Chief Justice, and the chairman of the NJC, had declared Justice Pendiga of any offense. It has gone to that.
But before we, as we proceed, I wanted to sort of establish, if you will agree, that nobody is saying, I don't think, lock, stock and barrel, the Nigerian judiciary is rubbish.
No, sir.
Because a tree does not a forest make.
Let me give
the presidency has put out the statement. I think I was reading Garba Shehu speaking for the presidency, that this is an action not against the judiciary, but against corruption.
For God's sake, let me say it for all intents and purposes, that I have my highest regard to the greatest majority of Nigerian judges who are doing their job as expected, in accordance with their oath of office. But there are these
elements. And they are in the majority.
They are in majority. But there are these elements who are few in number, but they have been emboldened by the corrupt, perverted system.
And are probably causing much damage to the reputation
of the others.
You know, of the others.
And look, people like us, perhaps, we have been concerned. We've been raising questions. We've been talking. We are regarded as enemies and critics. But the truth of the matter is that when it has gotten to the stage where ministers in the temple of justice are engaged in acts that are impinging on national security, the government of the day has a duty to act and act with dispatch. And that is what the DSS sting operation is all about.
And I guess a lot of people, not being a learned person myself, a lot of learned guys out there, AKA lawyers, they are saying that, wait a minute. There's a matter of decorum. This is, you can't rubbish the whole system. You do things properly, as befitting the status of the law and all of that. This is true. In fact, there are those who have gone as far as to say this is a whole conspiracy to sidestep due process in order to get at those who, you know, they perceive as enemies. They being, of course, the government.
Then let me respond to that by laying the following grounds. Unfortunately for us, the Nigerian Lawyers Privileges Committee had been terribly perverted from its course. May the soul of Allah Akaba Sharon rest in peace. If he had remained for one more year as the president of the NBA, we were working seriously to transform that committee so that it produced the same positively directed privileges for senior lawyers as it obtained in Great Britain. Today, sonship and the likes is man no man scenario. It is itself compromised completely. And that's why you find that quite a number of these so-called senior lawyers. I'm coming, sir.
You don't feel a sense of trepidation saying that as a lawyer yourself?
Is it not too late in the day for people like us?
Because to continue to say the other side, the privileges committee can say that if it were a political party, this is anti-party activities.
The truth must be said. I'm a man of faith, and I must be ready to tell the truth, no matter whose us is God. Look, quite a number of 2, 3, 4. President of Nigerian Bar Association have been calling for the withdrawal or the prosecutorial powers or the EFCC from them. Why are they so much interested in that?
Mm-hmm.
And many of them have been calling out. It's as if everything is against the judiciary, is to destroy the judiciary. I dare say that their views are misplaced and self-serving. When you fail to take out, exercise the negative ones from the Nigerian judiciary, the totality of the Nigerian judiciary will turn out to be a thing of disgrace as it has started to become.
Mm-hmm.
Let me remind our people.
One moment, please. I beg your pardon for interrupting you. I did so because we have a retired judge on the line, an octogenarian, Justice Opeoluwa Ogunade, and he's been listening for, you know, since we started the program. Good morning, Justice Ogunade.
Good morning.
Thank you very much for taking our call, sir. As you've been listening, we're talking about the judiciary right now and the situation it finds itself in. Could you kindly give me your impression, sir, as a former officer in the Temple of Justice?
Thank you very much. In my view, I'm just going to be brief.
Sure.
I cannot be as detailed as Mr. Ayokwadokun. He combined quite a number of qualities, journalist, politician, and all.
Oh, my God. My Lord, thank you, sir.
He might not remember that I know him very well.
So, thank you, sir, my lord.
Now, in my own view, when you become a lawyer, as Mr. Opadokun had said, you swear to observe certain ethics. You have to do your work honestly and having regard to the fact that at the end of the day, you're going to give an account to God. And that goes through the entire profession, whether you're a legal practitioner or you're a judge. It's worse for a judge. At your swearing in, you have to take two oaths. Your judicial oath enjoins you to do justice to everybody, irrespective of who they are, irrespective of their sex, their religion, or whatever. And we should remember, all of us, whether you're a legal practitioner or a judge, that the matter of justice is like a patient going to a doctor. He has pain, he wants the pain assuaged. He shouldn't come to you and ask, and you add to his pain. When a case before a judge is clear, when a case is clear, you are required to look at it and judge according to evidence. Unfortunately, for all of us who had served as judges, we see a situation in which all of us are condemned as corrupt. I don't blame them, because it's the norm. It's the norm in society. I'll give you an example. When I was on the bench, I had a controversial chieftaincy matter. And he was believed, because of the circumstance, that I should have been bribed. And letter was written to me saying that I've collected a bribe of 1 million naira. So I had to think quickly. Should I now say that because this had been done, I'm not going to do the case? I regard it as either blackmail or a cheap way of asking me to take my hands off, but I made up my mind. I've decided I'm going to do justice to all manner of people, irrespective of who they are. I called the lawyers, I told them I'd received this letter, and they are free to take their case away. But each of them said, we know you. This case is not leaving this court. I got to the court, I read the letter to the public, and I told them, for me, I'm not taking this case away. This allegation has been made. By the time that I start the case, whoever has given me money, if I'm not doing his bidding, he's free to go and report and come and collect his money. But thank God, it's through his mercy and grace. I sat on the case, I finished it. I finished it in 1998. Up till now, the case is still lying at the Supreme Court. So, the moment you are there, you know the situation you are going to. I was a legal practitioner all the time. I never worked in the civil service. And in fact, I went there because I was asked to come. And I knew that I was going to make sacrifice.
Okay. But Justice Ogwade, I beg your pardon, Justice Ogwade, what do you think about the sting of the DSS over the weekend? Lawyers, some lawyers have complained, some are in agreement.
Well, if you're asking my view, I think the DSS should do his work as he knows best. The lawyers who are complaining, they are complaining because they are custodians of this fundamental rights, they are fighters for fundamental rights. But except unless you have all the facts, the DSS will not just wake up one day and start invading people's house. They have facts. The lawyers who are complaining, I don't know whether they have the same facts, but I should really have thought that more inquiry should have been made before we start, this wholesale condemnation of what they had done. Mm-hmm. That's the way I have seen it.
Okay.
If I don't have a fact, I don't start condemning you. I don't start commending what you have done. We must have the facts. But the only point I'm going to make is this. Why should a judge allow himself to be dealt with in this manner? Your job is secret. Your job is not just the job of a human being. You owe a duty to yourself and to God. And if you realize that at the end of the day, you are going to appear before a judge, before whom there is no advocate, and he will decide your case just as he had seen it, you'll be ready for punishment. That's my view.
Thank you very much, Justice Ogwade. One last one before you go, sir, if possible. The Attorney General has alleged that the NJC has persistently looked away from the list it has sent them for investigation. Any comments on that?
My answer is simple. I've said it before. The Attorney General of the Federation is a member of the NGC, I believe. Maybe not. But the NGC has its own facts. The Attorney General has its own facts. The Attorney General is a government official. The NGC is set up by the Constitution. Has he ever complained about these matters? Has he ever raised the matter with the CJN, even though he's the chairman of the NJC?
Okay.
I mean, it's like a house divided against itself. I can't understand.
All right, then. Thank you very much, sir. Justice Okpeoluwa Oguade, for talking with us. Thank you, sir.
Let me just make a little comment on my law's comment over this matter.
Yes.
But with the last bit of it, mm-hmm. about the NGC and the Attorney General. From the report openly declared to the Nigerian media and to the public by the DSS, there is none one of these matters that had to do with any of these judges arrested that had not been on his table, the table of the Chief Justice of Nigeria, for more than 6 months, some of them up to 1 year. Confessional statement, evidence, the hard fact evidence before them, before him. What has he done? And that brings me to a major matter of concern to us. The constitutional provision that makes the Chief Justice of Nigeria, the sitting Chief Justice of Nigeria, the chairman of the NGAC, has outlived its usefulness. It ought to change. It must change now. We will never have a positively directed, reoriented Nigerian judiciary with the sitting Chief Justice of Nigeria presiding over the National Judicial Council, because the constitutional provision again allows him a lot of room to maneuver in the composition of the NGAC. Only his own kind of persons admissible. Yes, other organs will nominate their persons, but if he were to be opposed to such a person, that person will not get in. And we have found that one in practice. There used to be a Chief Justice, a retired Chief Justice of Nigeria, called Justina Katsina Alu, mm-hmm. who wanted the President of the Court of Appeal to change, to ask the Appeal Committee on the Sokoto governorship election to give a different ruling. And the President of the Court of Appeal, the distinguished and revered Justice Isaiah Yosalami, said no, nothing doing. Chief Justice Katsina Alu, Chief Justice of Nigeria then, wanted that appeal panel to be disbanded. And Justice Isaiah Salami said nothing doing. He was not going to do that in good conscience. And you know what followed? Eh? Because the Chief Justice of Nigeria was such all-powerful. Eh? He got the president, Nigerian President Jonathan, to suspend Isaiah Salami from office, and he was not returning to his office on his retirement. That is as evil, as dangerous as the current constitutional provision can be on the NGAC. So I must let you know that when it has gotten to a point when our own senior lawyers are the ones fixing money into the accounts of sitting judges who will be dealing with matters of their client, we already get into a situation of anarchy, because we are losing the confidence of the ordinary man on the street in the judiciary, which is supposed to be the arbiter in every situation. Remember that just in September last year, 32 judges, both senior and magistrate, were dismissed. Justice Zuma, president of South Africa, was passing through his own already. He was forced to go and pay back public money he had expended on his own private homes. Only that, with particular reference to our situation here, Nigerian judges for over the, since the advent of the military, we've started having major problem with Nigerian judiciary. Even though once upon a time, Nigerian judiciary was one of the best in the Commonwealth. That was why the likes of Justice Udo Udoma, Justice Akinola Aguda, Justice Taslim Elias, Justice Bola Ajibola, Justice, what did her name? They've been sought for by the Commonwealth and by the world. In fact, Dr. Lou Onagurua himself wrote the constitution of one of these Central African countries. Here was a time when our judges, our judiciary was one of the best things to be proud of in the whole Commonwealth and the whole world. But when the military came, with the organogram, the military commander-in-chief constituted a motley crowd of his military junta. So he himself would be along with those junta, they will constitute what they call the AFRC, Armed Forces Ruling Council, or Supreme Military Council. And therefore, so the military will be the executive. That body, Supreme Military Council, will become the legislative, the legislature. And then again, they constitute that body also to become a judiciary, because they lay accusation against their colleagues.
And you think
they investigate.
And you think that's where the seeds of today came
from? No, that's why it started. They started frustrating judiciary from day one, from the first decree. And when the acts were not to be condoned by the Nigerian bar, as led by the late Justice Chief F.R.A. Williams in the Kikeloma Adamalekun's case in Ibadan, they promoted the suspension and modification decree, which empowered them to make laws that, and they gave out after clauses in those laws so that you could not go to challenge those decrees. And that's where it started, until Bangida came into public governance. And then the desecration of Nigeria judiciary became so enlarged. Come to think of it.
Okay.
Do you remember?
I got to go to a break now.
Okay.
We'll come back and we'll continue with this. And you think, actually you seem to be saying that it was from the Babangida administration
that
it all began to go downhill.
Downhill. That's my...
Stay with us. We'll be right back and we'll take your calls. Okay, welcome back. We're looking at the judiciary and their travels. We have Mr. Ayo Apadokun, who is a legal practitioner, a senior member of the bar. We left on the note that the military didn't do, the judiciary much help. But since then, lawyers could have taken it back, couldn't they?
It
if
was...
they had wanted to, since if their profession had been quote-unquote desecrated by the incursion of the military, why do you think lawyers weren't ready to take it back?
Yori, I think Nigerians know, quite frankly, that the military had affected the Nigerian sociopolity negatively, so strongly and so pervasively. Only the kind of persons, their fellow confederates, surrogates, sympathizers, have been appointed into judiciary severally. And the manner of appointment of judges also has followed the same line. Loyalists to them as military administrators, military governors and the likes are the ones who are considered for the high bench. So we were here when the chief judge of Lagos State told us that the decree of the military was from an almighty in the 80s. It has gotten to that stage. So let us settle a few things that are connected with that. One of the issues that we must confront ourselves with is this. I raised two at the beginning. that the judges don't have constitutional immunity. So all this talk about desecration of the judiciary is bonkum story. Two, talk about odd hours. Which odd hours?
No, but that has been sorted out. People who weren't aware that there had been an amendment to can actually serve.
Also, I hope they are shot permanently. But I expect that lawyers should be abreast of the current laws and enactment before making funny statements to ridicule themselves. Yeah? Number three, the act of these judges is not just about criminal of matter of Naira and Kobo. Their conduct tended to impeach on national security. Let me give you an example. You have not heard the last over the matter of the River State, that a sitting governor called Wike could go ahead now to openly confront and prevent a government agency from performing their lawful duties, saying he as chief security officer will not allow a judge of a federal high court to be arrested. I've never heard of a thing like that in my life. I didn't know that we'd go to this death of the generation. When the senior lawyer did the same thing, preventing policemen from arresting his clients here, we thought that was the height of insanity. Look at what Wike had done. The allegation that $2 million US dollars was in that house. Nigeria must not rest. Buhari cannot afford to let that episode go undetected and unpunished. The immunity over a sitting governor does not confer on him getting into criminal act and acts that are treasonable and then be let scot-free.
You know, it's interesting because we're so polarized, it would appear. I have heard commentary that where is the money? How did the EFCC, how did the DSS, how were they able to tally? Since when did we become so efficient? How come they were? So you see that there's a division.
Honestly,
there's a division. It doesn't matter what you say.
Yori, the truth of the matter is that I've tried to do a content analysis of the various views. And I found that the totality, significant majority of those who are making such fantastic statements are either former PDP or current PDP members or beneficiaries of the wicked, dangerous system at least, or few ignorant ones. There's a young colleague of ours who was on the television about 2 or 3 days ago saying, no, the court is a holy place. Even the judge's house is an extension of that. So it should not be violated. These judges, when they took their office, were they engaged to serve as banks? That the DSS now has now presented what they got in the home of almost every one of these judges. What is a judge doing with 54 million in his house? $117,000 US dollars, and then scattered all over the house.
That's a very awkward scenario,
and that
right there.
And that so many of them, like,
but nevertheless, lawyers say there must be due process.
That's what they are following. When they have complained to the Nigeria Judicial Council for between 6 months and 1 year, and nothing was forthcoming. Look, and all of you, my dear Yori, on behalf of Nigerian people, you have been asking questions that for almost 1.5 years. General Buhari's offensive against corruption had not yielded any significant gain. Yeah? No big man had been convicted. How can you have conviction when you have these compliant judges, compliant senior lawyers, doing everything to frustrate the normal run due process of judicial system? They bring, for example, look at what they have done in the case of the Code of Conduct Tribunal. How many times now have the Nigerian senior lawyers, with their in their Braga show, they went and said the judge was not fit and proper? Eh? The judge said he was fit and proper. He rejected the appeal to disqualify himself. They went to the Court of Appeal. The Court of Appeal ruled in favor of the man. They went to Supreme Court. The Supreme Court said the man was fit and proper. They came again with this same the same set of argument, but cornered, camouflaged, choreographed in another thing. Then just to frustrate the trier.
Yes.
So how do you get? You must do something. Look, this man presented to the Nigerian people
but in
the campaign.
That's what lawyers do, isn't it? I mean,
lawyers
use the law.
They are supposed
Let me read something for you here. Professor Kole Omotosho, well, he put out an opinion yesterday.
Oh, this is Kole Omotosho?
Yes. Yeah, oh. And he says, well, let me just quote a bit of it. He's talking about using the law to outlaw the law. And he says, inter alia, he's quoting some, you know, John of Salisbury asks in his Polycrates, who is more intuitous than he who destroys the law by law and is beyond the law, even while he burdens others with the law? One more paragraph. This is a question the members of the NBA should be asking themselves. We have seen the situation in Nigeria, in Kenya, in South Africa, where senior lawyers have worked assiduously to ensure that their clients accused of corruption never get their days in court. And he concludes that part of it by saying, by using the law to outlaw the law, these senior lawyers create impunity among the high and mighty corrupt people. By the way, I don't know if you know Kole.
Well said. Professor Kole Omotosho is a distinguished academic. You just recently returned from South African University, a very close friend of mine. Distinguished and reputable academics. He's speaking my mind. And I take two quick things from that. Mm-hmm. The NJC, like the case of Joseph Pindiga that I just spoke to you about now, there's a rule. I don't need to tell the Chief Justice of Nigeria. Nemodex in Kosa Swa. No one is allowed to be a judge in his own, in his, no matter. Joseph Pindiga had been alleged to be having a deal of 500 million naira with justice, the Chief Justice of Nigeria, and was a confessional statement from the DSSS, and his own written statement thereafter, and yes, he has been declared non-guilty to remain in office. Our Chief Justice, therefore, has been a judge in his own matter. That's part of what just Kole Omotosho is talking about. And that's what they have what they have done. In most of the cases that have been brought to the attention, no judge has been recommended for criminal trial. At worst, what they have done is to ask them to go home. So all the loot they have taken, go and say no more.
You know,
That does not teach anybody anything.
Yes, and I think we need to say it again. We've said it before. This is not to say that the entire judiciary is rubbish. There are respectable officers of the Temple of Justice.
We said at the beginning.
And we said it at the beginning.
And I'm saying that the Nigerian judiciary had been a thing of beauty that we are proud of, even in the Commonwealth before. Here we had the likes of Justice Kayo Desho, Justice Chukwudipo Oputa, and Justice Oguntade.
Yes.
These are distinguished men and women you want to be associated with.
I saw a headline yesterday. It was from one of the papers. Which one was it? I think it was Premium Times, saying that, you know, sources from the security agencies say to them that there's been a deluge of petitions to the agencies because there's now an opening. They feel that following that sting, and now that people have seen what a few judges are capable of, they are now emboldened. And since they know they can't go to the NJC and hope to influence anything, they're just heading to the security agency, say, widen this your scope. And everybody has cases. Now, this is a very, very awkward situation.
Not only awkward.
Judiciary
I'm saying, as I'm reminding you, that it has something to do with Nigerian security. Because when people have totally become despondent and they don't have any regard for the Nigerian judiciary again now as an arbiter, then they resort to self-help.
Okay.
For example, in the case in election tribunal, Nigerian judges have turned it to the likes of what the armed robbers call it one chance.
Oh dear. Mr. Lawale in Ikorodu, good morning, sir.
Oh, good morning, Uncle Yori.
Thank you for calling, sir.
God bless you. My good daddy.
Thank you, sir.
We thank God for your life. Especially how you have been trying to make Nigeria better before you go.
Thank you, sir.
God will continue to bless you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Yes, it has been interesting. Both the bar and the bench are pathologically corrupt in Nigeria. It's quite unfortunate that it is the senior lawyers, as both of you have said, that corrupt these judges. They are the ones that will collect money from the client and tell the judges that don't worry, just handle the case, we'll give you this. Look at recently, a senior lawyer was caught writing exam for a student at the law school. But what do you want to do about that? I retired as an administrator in a reputable institution in Nigeria as a director. The public service rules only allow us to treat disciplinary measures, not criminal matters. So the NJC is allowed to treat administrative issues reported to it. But when it borders on criminality, they have to report it to the appropriate agencies.
Exactly.
They have not been doing, and the President Buhari that came to governance on the basis of fighting corruption cannot allow things to continue like that.
Thank you.
If the judiciary is destroyed, we are finished in this country.
Thank you very much, Mr. Lawale. And that brings us to something that I was going to bring up. Mr. Lawale brought it up there. This whole matter of change, the point has been made already that, look, this administration came on board on the mantra of change.
Yes.
Clearly, change, we've knew before, maybe it wasn't emphasized, change is difficult. Very, very difficult.
Oh, of course. The allegation is
that in the judiciary, there are people that are simply not either willing or able to change. And Professor Motosho made the point here that, look, when we want to get real, real serious about change, then we're talking revolution.
And I said so. You know, corruption is already fighting back. Corruption is fighting back very dangerously.
Okay.
But they will be defeated because I think some of our people, they have a wrong understanding of Buhari. I'm not a Buhari fan.
Or in his administration.
No. But I must confess to you that he has certain qualities that can help Nigeria in this circumstance. One of them is this. Buhari is not a relay racer. He's a marathon runner. They thought they could have outwitted him or they could have annoyed him to abandon the fight against corruption. They thought he would be tired. And they say, he's not doing anything again. It's only about corruption. So there are no economy, recession, because he's committed to all
you
those distractions.
You know all the arguments. Let me bring on Godwin, who is holding on in Ikeja. Good morning, Godwin.
Good morning, Mr. Yori.
Thank you for calling in, sir.
Now, I dot my heart for the learned man by
Chief Ayo Akwadokun.
Sorry, sir, I'm not a chief.
I so much appreciate what you people are doing.
Thank you, sir.
You see, we need to face facts. We need to come to the reality that this country must move forward. And how can the country move forward when you have corrupt people at the very sensitive places? My brothers, let me tell you, if anybody is talking about due process to arrest a criminal, though I'm sorry if I'm saying a criminal, but if there's an evidence that they have some money in some places, well, I see no reason why we should. What due process are we talking about to arrest people who are perverting justice? How do a judge get that kind of money? how many people that have been alleged of stealing money in this country that have been duly convicted? The only person in governor, as a governor, that I know that have been convicted, that I'm very sure of, was Ibori, and Ibori was not convicted in this country.
Oh.
What happened to the rest people?
Oh.
Why are the rest people not convicted?
Thank you very much, Mr. For calling in. Mr. Godwin.
That was what I was leading to. That is the act of conspiracy and connivance of these so-called senior lawyers and the compromised judges that has led to a situation.
People are leaving out the chief registrars.
Please, for God's sake, let's leave these other people, those who are just minions in this matter, is the connivance and conspiracy of these senior lawyers and the compromised judges that has led to a situation where these politically exposed persons, former governors, the EFCC filed action against them. All those matters have remained ordinary, just in the closet till tomorrow. Some ridiculous injunctions, frivolous motions, and the likes have been filed to ensure that those cases never took off till today. In fact, in one of the situations, they said no agency of government, either police, of SSS, of EFCC, can arrest, nor interrogate, not to say prosecution, or some of them.
We don't want to come away from that.
And we
need to come away from that.
We must.
We can't remain who we were and claim to be in change.
The reason why we are at this lowest ladder of human existence is because of corruption.
Okay. Mazi Okoro Afo. Good morning, sir. Mazi Okoro Afo.
Yeah, good morning, Mr. Yori.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir. Good morning, our guest.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Comrade Master Patrick Craft, for how to speak my name. You see, the judiciary is the last hope for the common man in the society. We should all join hands to make it strong. A situation whereby stories upon stories denting the image of justice is not healthy for Nigerian democracy. Integrity, credibility, and prudence cannot be bought from Alaba Market or Arada Market. It is impious. That is why we human beings, we should take anything we see at a particular time the way God wants it. Because it is only God in this that directs us and tell us what to do at a particular time. Whatever that is happening, that is what we call change. Change, you just say change starts from. Change cannot come and say maybe you change the recession to make money flow. No. Change comes from different angles. So as a Nigerian, born here, trained here, we should expect anything that comes anytime as a change. Because what is happening now have never happened. That is what we call change. Now, you define, now as Mr. Yorina, how do you define change? If you go to Advanced, you get different minimum. If you go to BBC, you get to, that is change. Thank you very much. Have a blessed day in Lagos.
Thank you very much. Well, that he says that this is change. We're in the middle of change, and it's not comfortable, and corruption allegedly is fighting back.
Yes, sir. I was trying to illustrate how critical the situation we are in is.
Okay.
That corruption is the very foundation for the level, the depth of poverty and economic misery of our people. The last statistical analysis that I read about a week ago shows that in the Human Development Index of 189 countries of the world, out of 196 under United Nations Organization, Nigeria is on number 156. And we are grouped among the war-ravaged countries of the world. Mm. It is corruption. That's why our social services are the worst. What the Nigerian state offers today as education is a deception. Our public officers have stolen enough. Their children are no more in public schools. So all the money that ought to go to public schools, the supervision and the likes have been stolen. So their own children are either locally in the very costly schools or abroad.
How are we going to fix this? I mean,
that
because,
is
because
why
it's about change, it isn't
is,
it?
That and, is, and, that's and, part and, of the thing. When it is no more easy for them to steal public fund, and there's no complicit judiciary to help them to retain their hold, give them very dubious punishment, then government will have enough resources. Then all of us, including civil society organization, we will have to sit down and monitor budgetary and its implementation to totally transform our society.
Now, I hear that, but I want to put an idea in your mind.
Yes.
The whole problem of change that we're working on now, you cannot achieve change, it is said. I was just reading this Omotosho opinion.
Yes.
Because you want to be part of the change. You want to be there when Nigeria is changed. But to go through change is to self-destruct. Because those who are benefiting the most from the status quo, quite frankly, are those who are going to be hurt should there be a change.
They will never, they will not
and so voluntarily. This is a problem we have.
They will not voluntarily allow it to happen. It's like self-suicide.
So we understand the magnitude of the problem on our hands.
And that is why I'm reminding them that Buhari is not a relay racer.
He's a marathon runner.
That man will not, he won't detract him. He's not, I don't agree with quite a number of his policies, but on this matter of his commitment to fight corruption.
You think we're in safe hands?
I'm in safe hands.
All right. We're going to have to leave it there. As always, it just seems like 5 minutes when we have a conversation like this going on. But thank you very, very much, Mr. Ayokpadokun. I'm never happy calling you Mr. Ayokpadokun.
But, sir, that is what I am.
It sounds a lot better to say Chief Ayokpadokun.
Oh, please. Don't put me in a borrowed robe.
Thank you very much for coming
on. It's a pleasure.
Really appreciate your coming.
It's a pleasure.
I'll be back tomorrow morning, God willing, with a fresh edition of the program. I'm Yori Folarin. Bye-bye for now.